Good morning. I'm Kitty Martin, and I'm with Nuveen. It's a pleasure to be here today and to welcome our next panel conversation, Beyond the Wage Gap, the Factors Harming Women's Retirement Security, and How to Fix It. Those who follow retirement policy know that preparing for retirement is especially challenging for women for a variety of reasons. Women have lower wages, lower access to workplace retirement plans, and often take time out of their careers for caregiving. This panel of experts will provide their insight on these and other retirement challenges facing women. Also, you'll hear an advanced preview of new research on this topic, which will be released in the coming weeks by the National Institute on Retirement Security. You may recall NIRS' past research on women and retirement, Shortchanged in Retirement, which remains widely cited by policymakers and the news media. Moderating this panel is Professor Regina T. Jefferson with the Catholic University of America. Professor Jefferson is a nationally recognized expert in pension and tax law. She's been actively involved in drafting pension legislation, has testified before Congress, and in 2015 was appointed by President Obama to serve on the Pension Benefit Guarantee Corporation's Advisory Committee for a three-year term and was reappointed in 2019 by President Trump. Professor Jefferson also serves on the NIRS Academic Advisory Board. Joining Professor Jefferson are Elaine Ryan with AARP, Joelle Saad-Lessler with the Stevens Institute of Technology and co-author of the upcoming NIRS Women's Report, and Emily Spreiser, legal director at the Pension Rights Center. Please welcome me in joining our panel.
Thank you for that introduction, and good afternoon. It is my pleasure to moderate the next panel, and I would like to take this opportunity to give you a little more information about our panelists. Immediately to my right is Elaine Ryan. She is the Vice President of State Advocacy and Strategy Integration in the Government Affairs Department of AARP. She leads a team of legislative staff who work with 53 state officers to advance AARP's state advocacy agenda, as well as with governors and state legislators throughout the nation. This work helps to enable individuals age 50 and over and their families to achieve and maintain financial and health security. Ms. Ryan earned a Master of Public Administration from the John F. Kennedy School of Government at Harvard University, and a bachelor's in economics from Fordham University. Next is Joelle Saad-Lessler. She is a labor economist with expertise in econometric modeling, statistical programming, and in-depth data analysis. She holds a bachelor's of arts and a PhD in economics from Columbia University. Dr. Saad-Lessler has published extensively on the American retirement savings systems, as well as on shortfalls in workers' retirement savings. Next is Emily Spreiser. She is the Pension Rights Center Legal Program Director. She provides legal and technical support to the Administration on Aging's National Pension Assistance Resource Center. Ms. Spreiser has prior experience at the Employee Benefits Security Administration of the U.S. Department of Labor, where she provided education and informal dispute resolution to employee benefit plan participants and plan sponsors and administrators. She holds a Bachelor's of Arts from Brandeis University and a JD from the Boston University School of Law. Again, it's my pleasure to serve as moderator, and I will now turn the floor over to our panelists, and Elaine will go first. Thank you so much.
Thanks so much. Good morning. Hello, good morning. Happy Women's History Month. for all of you fans out there. I do want to start by acknowledging a few powerful women, one of whom is in the room. So I want to acknowledge Jerry Madrid Davis, who's on our team working on state advocacy issues. And Jerry's been a long time champion for retirement security issues. We're lucky to have her with us, so thank you, Jerry. And please don't think of hiring her. Thank you so much. That's a paid announcement. My second is an acknowledgement of Sister Mary Cecilia, who was my second grade teacher in St. Patrick's Grade School, Lockport, New York, 14094, who wrote this admonition in my second grade report card, Elaine, talkative yet frank. So knowing that I have but 10 minutes to share with you, and I've already burned through almost 30 seconds, I will get on with the presentation. And I really thank you for the opportunity to be with you here today, because AARP's long supported this organization, but even more fought and used the great and powerful research of this group to help with our advocacy across the country. So here's some good news, bad news column. First, the good and bad news. The life expectancy for an American in 1950 was 68, and today a 10-year-old has a 50% chance of living to 104 years old. By 2030, just 10 years from now, the first boomer will have boomed to 85 years old. The first Gen Xer will turn 65 years old. And those millennials, okay, boomer millennials, will turn 50 in 10 years. So it is a rapidly aging country, and it really got our CEO, Joanne Jenkins, thinking about the fact that we need to do something radically different in this country to disrupt aging, to challenge some outmoded beliefs about retirement, and frankly, the systems that support workers throughout the country. One of my leaders at AARP is fond of saying we have a new term for retirement in this country. It's called work. While people know this, people are working longer, some because they want to, some because they must, because they don't have adequate savings. They don't have the ability to be able to stop and enjoy their mansions and yachts, and nor do I, by the way. But I will say one thing AARP has been working on, both in Congress and in the state houses, is to address what is age discrimination in the workforce. You know, 10 years ago, the Supreme Court had a laid down a decision that actually eliminated any federal protections against age discrimination. And we know one thing about women in the workforce, they're working longer, they're making up a greater percentage, they're more likely to be discriminated against due to their age. If they lose a job, they take longer to be able to get back into the workforce. And it's not only all women, but also African-American black women experience that age discrimination even more, and Hispanic Latino women as well. That's why AARP is working to try to put in place non-discrimination based on age in the workplace. And that applies to everyone. 30-somethings who are told that they're too young for that, 60-somethings who are told they're too old for that. Age discrimination really erodes economic security in this country. We're also working on changing some other pieces related to work, which is on the earned income tax credit. You know, if the age of retirement, full retirement for Social Security, may be 67 plus and growing, right, then why does your earned income tax credit end and only apply to people up to age 65? So we're working in several states to say, should there be any age cap at all in terms of the earned income tax credit? If you're working, earning, it could lift you out of poverty. This gets more upbeat, by the way. But I do want to say that, and a shout out again to Jerry and my team and our team of advocates across the country and so many leaders in this room. 55 million people go to work every day without access to a workplace savings plan. And we know people are 15 times more likely to save if it's offered at work. And so what we've been doing state by state is going to try to provide a simple way for small businesses to offer their employees a way to save. People thought that it was only a theory that Nobel laureates in economics actually advanced, that there is some connection with people. If they're offered, if you build it, will they come? And Oregon saves, the first state to move forward on this new law, have found they indeed do come. And just in the last several years, 66,000 new accounts of first-time savers have been opened in Oregon. And in Illinois, which enacted their law, in less than a year to their phased implementation, already 55,000 people have offered retirement savings accounts. Needless to say, women and women of color are less likely to have access to workplace savings accounts than anyone else. So we're making some progress, and actually last week New Mexico became the 11th state to pass a what we like to affectionately call a work and save law. We like to keep it simple at ARP. Just work and save, work and save. I will say today is Super Tuesday, and it isn't so super for me because I'm in D.C. resident who has taxation without representation, and it's not even my time to vote. But we fielded a poll at ARP recently in advance of the 2020 election called She's the Difference. And we asked women over the age of 50 what they believe is the most compelling issue facing America today. And overwhelmingly, the answer was healthcare cost, soaring healthcare cost. And we know that we have all the statistics to be able to demonstrate this fact. But think about the coronavirus today, and think about the fact that more than 50% of the people who are at work today have no paid or unpaid sick leave. And yet they're told, stay home, wash your hands, but people don't have the financial ability to stay home and take a pass on the income that they need. So we need to change those systems too. Why do we have such a fractured system that puts women further and further behind in their ability to work and earn? People have written about the sandwich generation with respect to caregiving. I like to call it the panini generation because the heat's on like ever before. And women are the front lines of healthcare. The average caregiver spends out of pocket $7,000 a year in annual income to care for their loved one. The average Social Security benefit, $14,000 a year. Think about those numbers. Women of color spend $9,000. African American women spend 44% of their income on uncompensated caregiving expenses for their loved ones. Caregiving is a rising issue across this country. It is eroding financial security for women who frankly don't have the choice between caring for their moms and losing their jobs. They have to do both. And it is taking a piece of financial security with every caregiving hour they spend. In fact, ARP did a study that showed that we have an estimated 41 million family caregivers in this country. If you were to add up annually how much they contribute to the nation's economy, it's $470 billion a year in unpaid care. By the way, that's more than the total earnings of Walmart last year. So we have this hidden economy, uncompensated, that's at the front line of caring, and we need to give them more support. And that's why ARP is moving not only at the federal level, but at the state level, family caregiver tax credits to be able to help people offset those costs of caregiving that erode their economic security each year. And we are seeing states, that's Sister Mary Cecilia saying it's time. But what does she know? She's passed away. But I do want to say this. That's irreverent. But let me just say this, that at this time, and one of the biggest campaigns that ARP is launching is on the soaring prices of prescription drugs in this country. You know, people are stopping taking medication. They're cutting pills in half. They're deciding what their doctor prescribed and then deciding maybe I'll take a third as much because I can't afford it. And those aren't just rhetorical comments. The analysis we did showed that 30% of Americans are either taking a pass on their medication or changing their own medication because they can't afford it. So we have lots to do. I don't have time to talk to you about long-term care cost, but you know a nursing home costs about $100,000 a year. Put your retirement savings into that against that bucket. And home care is about $50,000 a year. It's for 1 year. That's no surprise why my bumper sticker in my office is long-term care, fix it before I need it. And I'm happy to talk at the question section about some innovative things states are doing to help close the gap. I will say that our organization was founded 60 years ago by a woman, Ethel Percy Andrus, who was a school teacher, who found one of her colleagues living alone in a chicken coop because she had no pension. She had no health care. And Ethel stood up and decided to start the National Retired Teachers Association that later became AARP. So, Ethel, we've never stopped fighting, and will continue to do so, because savings is just one piece. It's what drains those savings that may be the most compelling point of all. Thank you.
Next, we'll hear from Dr. Joelle Saad-Lessler. Thank you.
Dan, are the slides attached? Okay, so I wanted to share with you today some of the data work that we did. It's going to be coming out in the upcoming report. And so a couple of things that I wanted to point out. We wanted to look at what the current retirement security situation is for women and point out any changes. So one of the things that we looked at, this is comparing 2012 with 2014, okay, looking at calling it the retirement landscape, participation, offer rate, eligibility. So there's a little bit of good news, okay? The good news is that the offer rate has gone up. Fewer women, as well as fewer men, were not offered a plan, meaning a lot more people, a lot more women are being offered a plan at work. Unfortunately, the numbers who are not eligible to participate have gone up. So that offset the good news. But in the end, when you take into account the change in the offer rate, the change in the eligibility, you end up with the top line, which is the participation. And so you find that the participation didn't really budge. So even though the participation didn't budge, in reality, underneath that, there's stories going on of, yes, companies are offering to their workers, but the workers aren't necessarily participating. And, you know, why is it that they're not participating? The bottom one is they're choosing not to participate. That's not the big one, really. It's the fact that they're not eligible. And by the way, this is a big issue specifically for women, because women are more likely to be working part-time. They're more likely to be not have worked enough years to be eligible. So another slide. This is looking at retirement preparedness for those ages 18 to 64. And this is specifically looking at how much people have saved up in defined contribution accounts. Okay. So a little bit of good news there as well. Because the stock market has rebounded, right? So basically the amounts that have been saved are higher, both for men and for women, at the individual level. Okay. The interesting thing to me is the value of household DC accounts, and this is actually more important for women than for men. Doing this calculation is important because a lot of times when we're looking at individual savings for retirement, we're not taking into account that people make decisions at the household level, right? So a lot of times in a household, the different household members might say, okay, your employer has a better match rate, so you do the savings instead of me, right? So when you take into account the household defined contribution accounts, so it looks a lot better for women, right? And that's good news. On the flip side, this kind of should be sending us warning signs as well, because realize if you're married, you're living in a household, very nice. So, but then if you get divorced, it's not going to be as nice, and you're, you know, kind of kicked back to the first line where it stinks for you, right? So, but overall, the value of DC accounts has gone up for both men and women. Participation in DB accounts inched up a teeny bit, but not, you know, again, I think if anything, even with the good news, the numbers here speak to the precarity of the system and the fact that in the current retirement savings system, where the assumption is it's in your court, it's on your shoulders to save, right? People just aren't saving enough. This is not enough to maintain your retirement. And we're going to see, I'm going to show you slides about sources of income, and you're going to see that in reality, people just, you know, how much they're saving in defined contribution accounts is just not cutting it. It's not going to do the trick. Okay? This is looking at retirement preparedness for people age 65 and over. Okay? So these are the people that a lot of them are retired already. And also for them, right, their accounts have gone up in value, both at the individual level and at the household level. Notice that for women, the amount that the household accounts pick you up is less than for the younger folks, right? For the younger folks, you know, the household savings are, it's less of a jump for those people age 18 to 64 than for those age 65 and over, okay? And participation in DB accounts is lower for those in the upper age category, okay? Okay, by the way, referencing back my comment about that the current retirement savings system isn't really realistic, is not a realistic expectation that this is what's gonna do it. Okay? Because in reality, if you look at how much people earn, okay, the top line, that's the age earnings profile for men who have defined contribution savings. Okay? Below it, okay, is the defined contribution age earnings profile, or rather, it's age earnings profile for men without a defined contribution account. Below that is for women, right? So the reality is just women don't earn as much as men. So if you have a retirement savings system that is based on how much you earn, it's women are always going to be at a disadvantage. It's that simple, right? So it's just, not, from my point of view, it's not realistic to have a system that says it's on your shoulders, it's how much you earn, because realistically, women don't earn enough.
And so they're always going to be unprepared for retirement relative to men. Okay. Looking at sources of income, this is for people ages 65 and over using the SIP 2014 data. Okay. This is the latest panel sample from the Survey of Income and Program Participation. So comparing what the results were in December 2013, what has happened moving forward to December 2016, okay? And there are more sources of income, you know, because we look at all the different possibilities, but the numbers are much smaller. So really for purposes of, you know, presenting the findings, we just focused on the biggest sources of income. And you see the biggest one is obviously Social Security. So Social Security is just a very big item for women, okay? And the reliance on Social Security has gone down a little bit, okay, both for men and for women. And there's some good news in the sense that where did that slack go to? Well, more women are relying on retirement income, okay, slightly, okay? Notice, by the way, the reliance on earnings, right? Even in 2016, 17%, if you take into account, this is the population age 65 plus, right? So this is the whole population 65 plus. This is not all 65-year-olds. This includes up to 80-year-olds. So the fact that this population, they rely for 17% of their income on earnings, to me, that's kind of a sad statement, okay? Okay. This is breaking it down by household income, okay? And here again, I'd like to just point out Social Security, women in the lowest income category, in the lowest household income category, those women age 65 and over, they rely for up to 75% of their income on Social Security, okay? And even for those in the highest income category, for those earning 80,000 plus household income, they're relying for 25%. So coming back to Christian's comments, the retirement crisis is not a crisis for poor folks. It's a crisis for everyone, okay? Again, this assumption that you have this retirement savings system that presupposes people are gonna save enough, this idea that we have a three-legged stool, it's really not a three-legged stool. It's 2 1/4, okay? People just aren't saving enough. The reality is they're just relying on Social Security, and it's not just the poor folks, it's everyone, okay? This is looking by marital status, okay? I want you to just pay attention to the widowed women. They rely on Social Security for 56% of their income, so they are, you know, the ones that rely the most on Social Security, and even those who are married, 50% of their income coming from Social Security. These numbers are unbelievably high. So you might as well call this presentation, raise Social Security, really. I mean, that's effectively what this is saying, okay? This is by age category, okay? And again, look at earnings. This is unbelievable to me. So women age 80 plus rely on earnings for 9% of their income. That's unbelievable to me. Those must be the tenured professors, I guess. It's just crazy, right? Obviously, the numbers for earnings go down with age. The numbers for Social Security go up with age. And retirement, best case scenario, I think that's a 19%. Right, for women age 80 plus. So it's not an equal, it's not this idea of the three-legged stool where savings are picking up a third and Social Security a third and your assets a third. It's just not happening. Okay, by race and ethnicity, look at the reliance on earnings among Asian and Latino is much higher, right? And that's because they rely a lot less on retirement and on Social Security. Among Black women, they have the highest reliance on Social Security. Again, emphasizing the importance of Social Security. Going back just a little bit, in terms of the income categories, household income category, another thing I wanted to point out, if you look at that last line, the percentage of observations, right? So you see that 19% of women are in households earning less than $20,000 a year. Compare that to men, only 13%, right? Women age 65 and over are in much more precarious situations than men, okay? So here is some good news, okay? If you look at poverty rates, the fraction of women who are in poverty has fallen from 2013 to 2016, from 8% to 7%. Similarly, that we don't see that for men, but the good news is not just for being poor, but even in the near poor category, right? Fewer women are in the near poor category, and in fact, more women are now not poor, where those are defined as not poor is above 200% of the poverty rate, okay? So those are the slides I wanted to, perfect timing, I wanted to share with you. You're gonna see all of the results, obviously, in the report that's coming out. So I guess that's all. Like I said, this is more, from my perspective, grow Social Security. So, thank you.
And next we'll have Emily Spreiser, who will address the impact of divorce on women.
Thank you. So as was mentioned, my name is Emily Spreiser. I direct the legal program at the Pension Rights Center. We are a national nonprofit organization. Our office is located about 3 blocks from here. And we have a policy side and a legal side. I run our legal program. We're federally funded to be a support center for 6 federally funded pension counseling projects around the country that provide free legal assistance regardless of age or income to individuals in 30 states. As their support center, we provide training and technical assistance to them as well as backup services in the 20 states not covered by a pension counseling project. Because we provide that help, we get a lot of phone calls and emails from people who need that help. And as boomers are retiring, we've seen dramatic increases in our call volume year over year. And so what we've come to realize is we're now getting so many calls and emails that we actually kind of have a national sample. And these calls are coming in from all over the country. So in 2018, we got almost exactly 2,000 inquiries from people across the country who needed free legal assistance, understanding retirement benefit, or obtaining a wrongfully denied one. And when we started digging into that data, we realized that around 1 in 5 were about divorce, and they were almost all coming from women. So we realized this was a big issue. So we started digging into that more and having conversations with different stakeholders in the retirement community who could tell us, you know, what's going on in the divorce space, and it confirmed our concern that divorce is presenting a huge issue, and a lot of people are really struggling to obtain the retirement benefits that they were awarded at divorce, and that is almost entirely women who had been contacting us. It's also a problem for other stakeholders like retirement plans and the family bar. So a few reasons why we should care about this. One, women are just way more likely to be poor in retirement, as Joelle made very, very clear. And divorce can exacerbate the situation. We know that divorced people are just more likely to face poverty or financial insecurity in retirement, and NIRS data actually shows that divorced women are more at risk than divorced men. It's also, you know, really important to note that retirement benefits are often the largest asset in a marriage other than maybe a home. So obtaining a share of a former spouse's retirement benefit makes a huge difference. It's also important to think about divorce because oftentimes if there are assets in a marriage, there's a negotiation process. So someone who understands the value of a retirement benefit may be negotiating away some other asset like a home or something else of substantial value in order to receive a share of a former spouse's retirement benefit. And then if they're not able to actually receive that retirement benefit after divorce, then they've now lost 2 significant assets. The difficulty that people are having stems from an inherently complex process. It's very systemic, and it's really hard for anybody to navigate the process of dividing retirement benefits at divorce, and that includes family law attorneys and other family law professionals and other practitioners. Simply put, a divorce decree alone is not going to be enough. You need to jump through a bunch of additional procedural hoops, and that's where people are getting lost. So I do know that a lot of the folks in the room today work for state and municipal retirement plans. Much of our work so far has been on privately regulated plans in the ERISA space, but there are a lot of parallels, and the procedures that governments use to divide retirement benefits at divorce oftentimes are very similar to what we're seeing in the ERISA space, so that's the lingo I'm going to use. But essentially, your divorce decree first has to divide the retirement benefit, and then there needs to be an additional court order, which has to get submitted to a retirement plan, and the retirement plan then needs to accept that court order. If they reject it, you need to basically redo the order and resubmit it to fix whatever concerns the retirement plan had. And if that doesn't happen, you don't get a share of the retirement benefit. And a lot of people don't recognize that they need this additional court order, and that includes family law attorneys. So oftentimes people have a divorce decree that says you're entitled to a share of a benefit. Under state law, you're entitled to a share of your former spouse's benefit. That share may be very significant. But then you don't take the additional steps to actually notify the retirement plan, and then something happens. Your former spouse who earned the benefit dies or remarries or takes the benefit out as a lump sum, and now you don't have a retirement benefit anymore. And this is happening to a lot of people. So we're seeing specific pain points that are occurring, like specific points in the process where people are kind of falling out and losing their benefits. So one is that the divorce decree doesn't address the retirement benefit in the first place. Now, most state jurisdictions require that people disclose their assets at divorce, and retirement benefits are one of the things included in the worksheet you're supposed to fill out. However, a lot of people simply don't disclose their retirement assets. Sometimes that's because they're intentionally hiding an asset, which we see a lot. But oftentimes it's because they don't know they've earned a retirement benefit. It's very common for people to work somewhere long enough to earn a benefit, leave, years pass, they reach retirement age, and they don't realize that there's money on the table that's waiting for them. And so if you go into a divorce not knowing you've earned a benefit, you're not going to be able to disclose that. So oftentimes it's just an accident that it's not being disclosed. The problem there is it's extremely difficult to reopen a divorce once it's been finalized. So you can't just go back and fix the divorce decree, and it's very onerous. You may need to get a family law attorney. So if you're already long divorced and you realize that there's a retirement benefit out there that you didn't address, you know, you might not be able to afford an attorney, or it may just be too onerous a process for you. So oftentimes, if it's not addressed in the divorce decree, that's the end. Then we see situations where the divorce decree addresses the benefit, but the parties don't know they need this additional order. In ERISA world, it's called a Qualified Domestic Relations Order, or QUADRO, or QDRO. For the federal government, it's called a Court Order Accessible for Processing, or COAP, and state governments may have their own term for it. I'm going to use the word QUADRO, but how many people in the United States have actually heard the word QUADRO before? Great. Right, but like, how many of you guys feel like you really understand how these things work? Right, the actuaries. But I mean that's and thank you, because we need you as we move forward with our work. So I'm going to follow up with you. Right, but QUADRO is not a common term. It's not like prenup. It's not like Miranda rights. Most Americans have no idea what this thing is. So if you're a self-represented litigant going to divorce, and more than half of divorces in the United States involve at least one self-represented litigant, how are you going to know to even think about this thing? You don't have an attorney telling you what to do. And furthermore, family law attorneys don't really understand this process. They might know there's this thing called a QUADRO, but they're really afraid of malpractice. They don't understand the retirement system. So most of the time, if they even mention the QUADRO to the client, they say, hey, listen, I'm going to, you know, in your retainer letter, I'm going to represent you in the divorce. I'll get the retirement benefit mentioned in the divorce decree, but I am not doing your QUADRO for you. You have to find somebody else. And if you're lucky, they'll make a referral to somebody who can draft it for you. So what'll happen is the divorce decree maybe briefly mentions the retirement benefit, the divorce gets finalized, and now the client is on their own to find someone to draft this additional order. And then they have to submit it to the retirement plan, and then they have to make sure that the retirement plan accepts it, and then they're on their own if the retirement plan rejects it, which happens a lot. Judges and court staff are not playing a proactive role in this either, because they also don't understand the retirement system and because they feel that they have a responsibility to be neutral and to kind of stay out of it. So people are not receiving guidance. So they don't know they need a QUADRO. And even if they know they need a QUADRO, they don't necessarily know they need to submit it right away at the time of divorce. Theoretically, you can submit a quadro anytime up until retirement. But the longer you wait, the more risk there is of some type of intervening event, right? Your former spouse who earned the benefit could die. And if the retirement plan is not on notice that there's somebody out there with a right to a survivor benefit, that's considered to be paid and there's no benefit left. Your former spouse could take a lump sum benefit distribution and go to a different country with it or spend it all. Your former spouse who earned the benefit could remarry and then die, and that person could receive the survivor benefit, in which case you're out of luck. Or they could remarry, divorce that person, and that person could submit a competing quadro first, in which case you're probably also out of luck. So all of these intervening circumstances can happen if you don't submit your quadro immediately. And one of the big things that we're hearing people talk about is, oh, well, I have this thing that I got a few years ago. And I'm like, no, go send it right now. Even where people understand that they need a quadro and that it needs to get submitted quickly, they oftentimes struggle to find someone to draft it. There are very few people who specialize in quadro drafting because it requires expertise in both family state domestic relations law and the retirement system. I've had people who work exclusively on quadros tell me that there are only about 30 or 40 people in the United States qualified to do it. As I mentioned, family law attorneys typically don't do it. If they do it, oftentimes they don't do it well, which I'll get to. There are no pro bono options. Most legal services providers don't even do family law, let alone quadro drafting. I'm only aware of three small nonprofit organizations that do quadro drafting on a limited basis in three states. So if you know someone who needs a quadro drafted, who doesn't have the money to pay for it, and they are in California, Texas, or New York, I might be able to make a referral. Otherwise, they're probably out of luck. It's a very complicated process, and it requires plan-specific information. Because you can't order a retirement plan to pay out more than somebody earned, and you can't ask the retirement plan to pay out in a form of benefits it doesn't normally pay out. And so you need to actually understand the rules of the plan. So templates are really difficult. There are some people who are experimenting with universal templates and actually online LegalZoom-style software to maybe draft quadros, but that's still very preliminary. We've heard tell of this thing called a quadro mill. We know that there are quadro shops out there that are producing high volume quadros at a low cost. There hasn't been a lot of research done into how many of them there are or what their overall impact is. So we don't know to what degree they're producing effective quadros or how many people they're impacting. We do know from talking to retirement plans that they receive a lot of very poorly drafted quadros, so we don't know how quadro mills fit into that. And then many plans, though not all, have something called a model quadro, which seems to be a potential solution if we can make people more aware of it, that would potentially increase access because it contains that plan-specific information people need. But people need to know to ask for a model quadro. Another problem is that the quadro stays a dro and is never actually qualified, never qualified by the plan, and so it requires the plan to do something it can't do. The plan doesn't understand what it's supposed to do. The actuarial math is bad. And if the plan rejects it, you're back to square one, and if you're not represented by an attorney at that time, you're probably done. You're probably just not going to get the benefit. And then finally, we see a lot of badly drafted quadros that have undesired effects. Maybe it meets the plan's requirements for qualification, but they didn't understand the math, and so they ended up providing more, a much larger benefit to one party than was expected. We saw a quadro situation where the quadro awarded 100% of the benefit to the former spouse of the benefit earner, but in order to remain qualified for retiree health, he had to be receiving a benefit, and they hadn't looked into that. So the benefit earner ended up losing his health care because they didn't understand that giving 100% of his benefit to his ex-spouse, which seems like a nice thing to do, would ultimately harm him. They don't account for taxes. They forget to include the survivor benefit, which is a huge problem because somebody who may have been relying on a share of their former spouse's retirement income might suddenly no longer have that benefit because the former spouse died and the quadro didn't address survivor benefits. And sometimes the mistakes are just awful. DB plan, like model quadros for DB plans get submitted to DC plans and vice versa. So there are a number of problems here, and plans are also finding that this is a huge struggle because it's really expensive for them, and oftentimes they get dragged into family court actions, which dramatically increases their expense. So All that is said, we are embarking on an initiative called the Pension Rights Center Initiative on Women and Retirement at Divorce. It is a common ground initiative to find solutions to all of these problems. We're working directly with retirement plans and other stakeholders like women's groups and legal services organizations, the domestic violence community, organizations that represent women of color, and the LGBT community. To come together to try to identify solutions. We just engaged in phase one, which was a year of information gathering activities, and we are now embarking on phase two, which is the actual implementation of solutions that have been identified. We'll be forming task forces, if anybody's interested in getting involved and looking at you actuaries, or anybody else. We would love to have anybody on board who thinks they have a role to play. Please feel free to seek me out. And we are engaging in things like public education, expanding access to model quadros, providing trainings for legal services providers, and working with plans to refine their procedures for accepting submissions and clarifying why a document may not have been accepted. So with that, I'm going to turn things back over.
Thank you, Emily. Please, could I ask you to join me in thanking our panelists for wonderful presentations? Thank you. Before turning the floor over to you for questions, I'd like to begin by asking the panelists questions and ask you to briefly respond, if you would. I'll start with you, Elaine. In view of some of the developments that you identified, such as living longer, increased health care, can you identify some of the most effective measures that you've seen taken by state policymakers to respond to these issues?
Yeah, so there are a number of things I mentioned. So I'll set work and save aside, but there's some interesting things that are going on in terms of offsetting the cost of caregiving. You know, Arizona, not one that would have been at people's top of the list, actually put together a $1,000 a year caregiver stipend last year to help family caregivers offset their cost. And there are other states, another 12, that are working on caregiver tax credits. One for long-term care, Washington State passed a long-term care trust fund that's a small contribution to a payroll tax, an accumulated trust fund that will be able to pay out funding to help people meet their long-term care needs. In Missouri this year, actually already passed through one house, a $5,000 savings account for long-term care that would allow people to actually defer those earnings from taxation. We have a dozen states working on paid leave. We need more, and I guess my takeaway is that there isn't one remedy that will fix this. But one that's driving healthcare costs that I really encourage people to check out our Stop RX Greed campaign at AARP is just the astronomical increase in prescription drug prices. We pay the highest prices for drugs in the world by far, and they're escalating with no end in sight. So they're driving up, those prices are driving up the cost of health care. They're driving up state health care costs, Medicaid costs, Medicare costs. And for people struggling with out-of-pocket costs, people are going without, jeopardizing their health because of those. So it doesn't take just one action. It takes all of us stepping up to raise our voices on any of the actions. It's coming at a state legislator near you. And if Congress, as Washington waits for almost everything, we are working at state legislators, legislatures across the country to move change.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Joelle, you had mentioned that the focus of your charts was primarily on the traditional sources of income, that being private retirement savings, personal savings, and Social Security. You also indicated, however, that there were some other sources that were not as significant. Can you address what those other sources are, though, and speak a little bit to minimal significance they might have for retirees in general and women in particular?
Right. So there is the other categories I'm trying to remember from off the top of my head. There is property income, there is transfer income, and other income. Honestly, you know, really much lower than the other sources of income, the three that I put up there. And interestingly, if you look at median, so these numbers were means. okay?
Yes.
If you look at the median numbers, it's just Social Security and earnings. Everything else just zeroes out, literally. Okay. Like, even the retirement, like, you know, you saw, like, you know, in the teens, the sources of income, but honestly, median, zero. Mm. So, you know, even though there are other sources of income, they're just not very big.
Okay. All right, thank you. And Emily, you have certainly described some of the complexities involved with quadros. Can you speak to what the responsibilities of the retirement plans and plan sponsors are regarding the shortcomings of the quadro process?
Absolutely. So first of all, in our conversations, we have found that retirement plans overall are very enthusiastic about this initiative and about trying to make changes because quadro administration is one of the largest expenses for retirement plans. And as I mentioned briefly in my remarks, a lot of plans are getting dragged into family court, which is not a place where they want to be. They don't want to be involved in deciding who's entitled to a benefit. They just want to make sure that they're complying with the law and paying out the benefits that they owe. So they've been really enthusiastic about it, and we've been engaging them in a number of different potential solutions, which include, you know, making sure that plans that don't already have a model quadro have one, and talking about ways that plans that already have model quadros can improve those model quadros and benchmark with other plans. We've talked about things like making some type of online model quadro repository available and other ways to disseminate model quadro information, and checklists that family law attorneys or legal services attorneys assisting a self-represented litigant could potentially use in order to build a model quadro or at least to make sure that they're navigating the quadro process. We also really want to engage plans in public education. They have a direct line of communication with their participants. We want to make sure they're also communicating with their spouses, right? Why not tell people this information before it ever even becomes a problem, long before divorce is even being contemplated? And make sure that spouses have access to the benefits information that they need. One of the biggest struggles that former spouses have during this process is getting plan information. We see a situation where the divorce has happened, so you're no longer technically entitled to a benefit without a quadro, but you need a quadro to get the information because the plan won't give benefits information out to somebody who isn't entitled to a benefit. So it's this weird circle where you need a quadro to get info, but you need an info to get a quadro. So, you know, absent some change in the law that would require plans to provide that information, it seems that the best time for former spouses or current spouses to get that information is before the divorce is final, and we want to work with plans to make sure they're actually receiving it, because they have a right to those benefits. It's within the law for them to get that information. And then refining the submission process. A number of plans, just in talking with us and with some of the other stakeholders, have said, you know, we could really make this change very easily, right? One of the recommendations we've had given to us was to make sure that when a plan accepts an order and qualifies an order, to provide a plain language description of the plan's interpretation to make sure everybody's on the same page and that the plan is actually interpreting the order to provide benefits in the way that the parties anticipated, so that if there are any surprises, they can work together to fix it. And other types of just small best practice recommendations for plans that can not only make it easier for the parties, but prevent a lot of hurt down the road for the plan itself.
Okay. All right, thank you. And I see that we have just a few minutes remaining. I'd like to, at this point, open the floor up for questions from the audience. Questions, comments? Well, we have 3 minutes left, and so with that, I will say thank you. Thank you very much. Again, thank you, panelists, for an excellent job.